Hi, it's Mike again. Welcome to another how-to video. In today's video, I'm going to show you how to repair these Blackstar HT5R amplifiers. The owner brought this one in to me complaining that after he played for a couple minutes, it would go all distorted and gritty and fizzle out, and eventually no sound would be coming out of the speaker at all. But he thought it was kind of funny how the emulator would still work just fine. So he thought it was a power tube, so he purchased a new power tube and put it in, and it actually did the same thing after about a month. So that led me to believe that it was some sort of biasing issue or a heat issue with the amplifier. Once the amplifier got hot, the biasing went out and it wouldn't work anymore. So upon some further research, I realized that this is a known problem with this amplifier, that there's something incorrect in the designing of the circuit board. So I managed to fix this amplifier relatively easy, and I'll show you what I did. Unfortunately, if it's less to its own avail, that the whole chip and circuit board will probably destroy itself and maybe not be fixable at all. So at least I'll give you some area on where to look and how to fix your amplifier. If not, you may need to get a new circuit board or buy a new amplifier in general. So I removed the amplifier from the cabinet, and the one thing I can't stress enough is please disconnect it from the mains and don't have it connected at all. And please let the amplifier sit for an extended period of time so the capacitors will actually drain and it's not lethal voltage in it. And if you know how to drain the power capacitors, please do so as well. So this amplifier is kind of unique. I would kind of call it a hybrid amplifier. So it does have a preamp tube, which is a 12AX7, and then also has a small power tube, which is a 12BH7. So it's just a small little power amplifier, good for practicing and bedroom usage and some studio usage. It has two channels. It has a clean and an overdrive channel and an equalization channel, standby on and off switch. And when you flip it over, you realize that yes, there is a lot of components and circuitry in here that can be kind of disheartening if you're trying to debug this, and to a point where some people just get frustrated and just give up on these amplifiers. But I'll show you what I did. The tube here, which was apparently a brand new tube, was all cloudy inside. So typically when a tube gets silver or white inside, it usually means that it's lost its vacuum. I can't see any physical cracks in here, so I can only assume that this tube was overbiased and it faulted somehow through the pins and just got way too hot and lost its vacuum. So this tube is no longer good anymore. So when a brand new tube feels like this, there has to be something with the operating parameters of this amplifier. Now, I did play this for about 2 or 3 minutes and it sounded good at first and then would slowly start distorting. So to me, that means it has to be heat related. So upon some further investigation, it turns out that these two transistors, they're MOSFETs, IRF830s, and they're labeled as TR2 and TR3, they are known to fail. So if your amp starts acting funny, just turn it off right away because you don't want them to fail completely. So I was able to kind of rescue this circuit board by installing huge heat sinks on them and replacing the two resistors there. R38 is a 20K and R39 is a 22K. So I took the board out, I flipped it over, I refloated all the solders joints in to make it work and make sure that all the leads and the traces on the circuit board were not touching each other. So to remove the circuit board from the chassis, what you do is you have to take off all the pots and unscrew all the knobs and the input jack. So there's about a half dozen Phillips head screws that you just undo and the chassis board will just kind of pop out. You don't really need to disconnect any of the leads. You should be able to just flip it over and get access to the back of those MOSFETs there. And as you can see, I already made the enhancements there. So the bigger resistors there, and I put the heat sinks on the MOSFET as well, which I do believe this needs. So this is the backside of the amplifier board, and these are the backside of those MOSFETs. Now this is actually what they call a more modern board, and it does have actual slots between the traces of the MOSFET, but I do believe that's still not enough. And some of the older boards, that you need to actually drill a small hole between these two MOSFET traces to make sure that there is no leakage through those contacts there. So what I'm going to do with this one is actually pronounce the holes even more so there actually is no leakage between the traces there. So what you do is you take a very, very fine drill bit, like a 1 millimeter drill bit, and you go in between the traces and you oblong the holes so there's no leakage through the MOSFET traces. And you can see how I made those holes bigger. So this is the power tube, and it's actually a 12BH7, which is similar to a 12AU7. They're very linear. This one, they're a little bigger and more robust than 12AU7. There's a dual triode in it. So there's actually two actual, what you say, amplifier portions in this tube. And you need to balance this to get the ultimate output of this amplifier. So that's why they have the test points here. So every tube is going to be a little bit different. So realistically, whenever you put a new tube in, you really should be balancing the triodes for the ultimate performance of this amplifier. So now that we got it all back together again, we're going to test the voltages on the power tube. So what we need to do here is put a dummy jack in for the speaker and also put a jack in for the input as well. So the input actually has a special standby switch that if there's nothing plugged into it, it actually goes into standby mode. But we'd want it to be in run mode. So just be careful. Now that when it's in run mode, we have high voltages in here. So you want to be very careful on how you measure the voltage here. And I'll show you that you want to test the voltages on TP6 and TP7. And we want those voltages to balance out to be the same. So around 22 volts is the optimal balance voltage of that. And the test points are right beside the power tube. So there's some pot there, the white thing, it says balance. That's the dial we want to turn. And we're going to use measure the voltage from TP6 and TP7, and we want to make sure that is the same. So put the tubes in, turn the amplifier on, make sure your dummy plugs are in, and then measure those voltages. Okay, so now I have it on DC voltage and the amplifier, I'm going to flick the standby on. Now I'm going to tap TP6, and you can see that it's minus 26 volts. So I'm going to touch TP7, and it's minus 24 volts. So that's out of balance. So now what we want to do is turn this balance pot with a screwdriver in order to get exactly the same voltage on that. And just a little bit of trial and error, but please be careful. So there you have it. I got the pots balanced. I fixed the resistors between the two. I fixed the traces on the circuit board, made them bigger so there's no leakage currents going through the MOSFETs on either leads, and then I put huge heat sinks on. So that is the repair I did for this amplifier, and it seemed to work pretty good. So I've been playing this amplifier for about an hour now, and I'm pretty confident that the repairs I made is the right fix for this board. Now, this is a known problem for this board, and sometimes it can be quite catastrophic, and if it is, then you probably will need a new circuit board. So if you do decide to take your amplifier apart, please make sure it's disconnected from the mains and that the filter capacitors are discharged, or let it sit for a while so it will discharge all by itself. You know, this amplifier does have some lethal voltages inside. So I hope that inspires you to take a look and see what's wrong with your amplifier. And once again, thanks for watching.